بسم الله الحمد لله السلام عليكم peace be unto you. What a beautiful greeting. This is a greeting that Jesus greeted his followers with, Moses, Abraham, all the messengers of God, and the last and final messenger, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon them all. They greeted their followers with this greeting of peace, and we are greeting you here today with that same greeting of peace. Now, I'm very excited, we're bringing out to continue the story of one man's road to Islam, who graduated with honors from the Harvard University. He was an ordained minister, a deacon, who started preaching the Bible at a very young age, and he was filling the churches, people excited to hear him speak, going to seminary school. He's a Muslim now. What happened? Did he take a wrong turn, or he took the right turn? Tell us now. Well, actually, he's going to tell us how he accepted Islam. When we come back here in the Dean Show, you don't want to go nowhere.
Allah, there's only one God, and Muhammad is his messenger. Allah, la ilaha illallah. Allah, there's only one God, and Jesus was his messenger. Allah, la ilaha illallah.
Why I did that. Maybe it's just to break the ice. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
For those people now, I wish you peace, you wished it back upon me. And I told them that's the greeting of all the prophets.
Yes.
And we also mentioned something about the beard last week. You want to just fill in the blank?
Well, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, instructed us to have beards.
Yeah.
And also in places instructed us to just let them grow.
Yeah.
And so I've let my beard grow.
And we addressed this last week. If you didn't see last week's show, that was part one to why Dr. Gerald Dirks accepted Islam. And I had mentioned that some people can't get past. One time my guest was wearing a, what do you call it?
Kufi?
Not a kufi, something else on the top of the head. And I had to have him address it. And once he addressed it, people, you know, they just start to understand a little better, and then they can appreciate it. And what we said in the first show is that Jesus, most likely he had a beard. And any picture you see, supposedly they try to paint Jesus, you'll never see him without a beard.
Hardly
or all the
ever.
Prophets. This is a pious way of trying to emulate, not the movie stars, but the best of humanity, the prophets of the creator of the heavens and earth.
Yes.
All right, so now, we talked about, and you can see this in part one, how you went from, at a young age, teaching, preaching the Bible, finishing and getting a divinity degree, and going to seminary school, and then from there, sum it up along with what I just said, and then we'll go on to the rest of the story, how you actually came to Islam.
Well, as we mentioned last week, in 1974, I graduated from Harvard Divinity School with a Master of Divinity. I was an ordained minister in the United Methodist Church. But at that point, I spent 3 months in that summer filling pulpits in two rural parishes in Kansas. And then in September of 1974, I left the parish ministry for good. I was still an ordained minister. I still believe very definitely in God. But coming out of my seminary education, as we talked about last week, I had no belief in the divinity of Jesus or in the concept of the Trinity, etc. So I started a path that I call my path of being an atypical Christian.
Mm-hmm.
Believe very much in God, prayed, read the Bible, studied new archaeological finds as they came out on the Bible and other Christian texts. But again, no belief in the divinity of Jesus, peace be upon him, no belief in a Trinity. And I basically continued in this line as an atypical Christian from 1974 until 1993.
Mm-hmm.
But the turning point actually started a couple years before I became a Muslim. It was 1991, and my wife and I for several years had been doing research on the history of the Arabian horse. And we had some Arabic documents.
What's the Arabian horse?
The Arabian horse? Well, it's a horse.
For people who...
the Arabian horse is a horse that was bred for centuries.
Mm-hmm.
by the Bedouins of the Middle East.
Okay.
They typically have one less vertebrae in their back and one less vertebrae in their tail than other horses, and they are the preeminent endurance horse.
Yes.
So we've been studying the history of the Arabian horse for a number of years and been writing about it. And we had some Arabic documents, hujjas, that had accompanied a shipment of horses in 1906 to the United States. Mm-hmm. These were the Arabic testimonials of purity and about the origin of these horses that came over in that year. Mm-hmm. We wanted to get them translated.
Mm-hmm.
And they hadn't been translated up to this point in time.
Yes.
And this brought us into contact with a portion of the Arab community in Denver, Colorado, that happened to be Muslim. And our first such contact occurred in the summer of 1991, and it was with Brother Jamal. And he came out to our farm, looked at our horses, glanced at the Arabic documents, and said, sure, he'd be happy to translate them for us.
Mm-hmm.
And we began that process a little bit here, a little bit there. But along the way, a very close friendship developed.
Yes.
And before long, we were getting together on a weekly to bi-weekly basis, just socially.
You weren't a little nervous, skeptical, thinking like, you know, had some preconceived ideas or notions that, you know, what you might have seen on TV that, you know, I got to be careful, this guy might be some kind of terrorist or some kind of...
Well, again, we're talking 1991, so it's a little before...
A little before all the drama.
Yeah, okay. But no, I didn't have any such feelings whatsoever. Along the way, and it's important, I think, to point this out, Jamal never proselytized.
Mm-hmm.
He never said, this is the way to believe.
Yes.
He never said, you ought to become a Muslim.
Mm-hmm.
However, that first time he came out to the farm, before he left, he asked if he might use our restroom to make ablution before praying. And he came out of the restroom and then said, you know, may I borrow a piece of newspaper to put on the floor so that I can pray.
So this is the ritual washing before one.
And then we gave him the newspaper, and he laid it out on the floor, and he did his prescribed prayer.
Uh-huh.
Now, again, he never said anything to us about, hey, are you Muslims, or why aren't you Muslims, or you should be doing this. His dawah, or his preaching, was in his behavior.
His actions, huh?
Yeah. His example. He prayed.
Yeah.
A very powerful form of preaching, actually.
Yeah, describe this prayer for us, please, for those who have never seen
it. Well, it was the standard Islamic prayer. It had the different postures. You begin standing, and then there are some things that you say. This was during the day, so he was saying them to himself.
Yeah.
And then you bow, and then after bowing, you stand again, and then you prostrate, and then you kneel, and then you prostrate, and you go through this... cycle, which is called a rakat.
Did you think he was praying maybe to a moon god, or did you think...
No, of course not.
No. Who did you think he was praying to?
To God.
To God?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. His understanding of God.
Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, social contact continued. We were getting together once every week to every 2 weeks. And as he continued to translate stuff for us occasionally, he would begin to share with us knowledge about the history of the Arabian horse in the Middle East.
Yes.
And along the way of doing that, he began to quote different verses from the Quran, or different sayings of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, different aspects of Islam, not to proselytize, but to give us a way of understanding the Islamic context of the history of the Arabian horse.
Yes.
So again, it was all presented not as proselytizing, but as you're interested in the history of the Arabian horse, I will seek to meet your needs.
Mm-hmm.
But in doing that, I'm going to have to explain this context to you so you really understand it.
Yes.
So this continued on, and over the next 16 months, our contact expanded, not just with Jamal, but also with Wael and his family, with Amr and his family, Ahmed and his family, etc.
These are just other Muslims.
Other Muslims. We're getting together socially. Again, no active or direct proselytizing going on. But in the process of observing these Muslim brothers, I became increasingly impressed with their behavior.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they were living a very moral and ethical life, bending over backwards to do it, as a matter of fact.
Yeah.